Okay, I think now I can give the floor to Roland for his next presentation. I think this will be the last presentation. I think if we have the time after the Roland's presentation, maybe I think Shireen can show some interesting slides in Arabic regarding the short chain chlorinated paraffins. So if we have the time after this presentation, so Roland, please go ahead.
Yes. Thanks. At a moment. And I put the link to the toolkit on contaminated sites already in the chat, so you can go to the Stockholm Convention website. My last presentation for the workshop is on securing health in a world of chemicals, starting with POPs towards best practice awareness raising on hazardous chemicals. So the World Health Organization on burden of diseases estimates that about 8 million deaths per year are attributed to ambient and indoor air pollution. And also the WHO estimates for this burden of disease from only selected chemicals at 1.6 million lives in 2016, and that more lives of many more people are negatively impacted by chemicals. This you can find in the Global Chemical Outlook from 2019 and in this study here from the WHO. Also, the Global Alliance on Health and Pollution have considered this WHO study, and additionally, they look to pollution from contaminated sites. Overall, they estimate that these are 8.8 million deaths in 2012, one out of seven, and that the deaths from pollution are considerably higher than all other deaths, including road injuries or malaria, tuberculosis, and that the other most close reason for death is smoking with 6.2 million deaths per year, but which is also kind of from chemicals and the polyaromatic hydrocarbons. So pollution and impact on health is very severe. A friend of mine made an assessment how many potential POPs are in use. So he screened the about 100,000 chemicals in chemical databases in the US and in Europe. And considering the POP criteria of the Stockholm Convention, and he found that about 574 potential POPs were found, mainly chlorinated, partly the brominated and fluorinated chemicals. So here, the 30 POPs, which we are at the moment are addressing by the Stockholm Convention, they are only the tip of the iceberg, but they are a good start. Because yes, now with the Stockholm Convention, we have fluorinated, brominated and chlorinated chemicals, which need an assessment and management. And POPs can be a start to assess these chemical groups. And as you have seen from yesterday, from the presentation, the European Union already recommend to look, for example, for the fluorinated chemicals to the total class of PFAS. And while we see, yes, some POPs were phased out and the levels are decreasing in blood and milk, more and more chemicals are produced in even higher volumes. Today, we have 350,000 chemicals, which are in different production lists. So while most of the old POPs were pesticides, today, many of the new POPs are POPs in daily lives, which with direct exposure to consumers. And when today a good analytical chemist analyze blood or human milk, he can find more than 300 of industrial chemicals in human blood and milk. And this shows clearly that there is a necessity to change a chemical policy. When we start to discuss, is human milk safe? WHO recommends for 6 months because the advantages of human milk by far overcompensates this pollution. But it's clear that we need to change a chemical policy to have reduced exposure. One chemical group, which Shireen already mentioned, I could hear it in Arabic, are the endocrine disrupting chemicals, which are disturbing the hormone system of humans and wildlife. So here the concept of endocrine disrupting chemicals was introduced by Theo Kalborn in 1993 in her book, Our Stolen Future, where she documented that environmental chemicals here disrupt the development of the hormone system, and that the effects of this exposure during development of a child or a fetus, they can be permanent. So also here, the WHO has published in 2012 a study on endocrine disrupting chemicals and the state of science. And basically, more or less, all of our POPs are endocrine disrupting chemicals. The health effects from these endocrine disrupting chemicals are reduced fertility, male and female reproductive tract abnormalities, change in male-female sex ratios, the loss of fetuses, early puberty, brain and behavior problems, and different cancers, especially breast cancer and prostate cancer. So when you look to the levels of breast cancer here for the 27 European Union countries, you see that they are increasing over the last 50 years here for all the countries. I have also one good news here, that while the breast cancer is increasing, overall the mortality of breast cancer has decreased over the last 30 years because the improvement of medicine was more than the increase of the breast cancer. So we are learning how to deal with these cases, but each case is of course a tragedy for each person. And anyway, still people are dying from this breast cancer. The same for testicular cancer. So testicular cancer are also increasing here for different European countries over the last 70 years. And in industrialized society, it is the most common cancer of young men. And when we look to the overall assessment of endocrine disrupting chemicals to the society, I show you two studies, one about the effect and external cost of endocrine disrupting chemicals here for the United States, where you have in the assessment that the biggest impact here is a POP, actually, the PBDEs and the IQ point loss and the intellectual disability, which is estimated for the United States to $266 billion external cost a year. For Europe, you see there is also a study on the external cost of endocrine disrupting chemicals. And here for the flame retardants, the estimate is much lower compared to the United States. It is estimated to 9 billion euro per year. And you have seen in my presentation on brominated flame retardants, the reason is that the levels are 20 to 50 times lower in Europe for the PBDEs because we have used a lower concentration. But when we look to the overall impact, also in Europe, the endocrine disrupting chemicals are estimated for a middle bound estimate to 157 billion euro a year. So these are several percent of the GDP. And here the most impact is estimated for neurodevelopment. This means the development of the child. And I can tell you that over the last 20 years, we have seen in Europe, but also in the US, increase of different child epidemics, including allergies, ADHD effects, and so on. For Europe, the chemicals with the largest effect of endocrine disrupting chemicals are estimated to the pesticides and to plastic additives like phthalates and bisphenol A. And certainly the impact of pesticides is very crucial on health. So the POPs pesticides have been substituted. We still have them in the human milk. On the other hand, today we have about 1,350 different pesticides on the world market, which are partly found in our food. So the assessment of these endocrine disrupting effects and the health related to costs to Europe, consider here the pesticides that they have the largest impact for our area. But finally, the largest effect on humans are for the farmers, which are using these chemicals, and for the people which are living in the surrounding. So the WHO estimates for pesticides and health that nearly 3 million agricultural workers suffer from acute poisoning of pesticides per year. Furthermore, WHO estimates that an additionally about 20,000 unintentional deaths and 735,000 cases of chronic illnesses occur as a result of pesticide exposure. Also here, I would like to make a positive message. Please have a look to Die Deutsche Welle, a short film about the possible end of pesticide and to move away and reduce the pesticide use. And also here, Europe has to aim to halve the use of pesticide in the coming years. So awareness is here the key for improving chemical exposure and chemical safety. Today, the risk assessment is done for single chemicals. So this is today the state of art of evaluating chemicals and giving production and use permits from policymakers. However, the risk assessment of a single chemical is not sufficient and not appropriate, considering that we are exposed by thousands or even ten thousands of chemicals with additive or even synergistic effect. Therefore, even the best chemical legislation is currently not sufficient to protect human and the environment yet. And this is also acknowledged by policymakers. So in Europe, for example, you have since more than 10 years activities which try to integrate additive effects and synergetic effects. But up to now, this is not in regulation because it is very complicated. Because of that, in addition to improving the policy frame on chemicals, consumers need to be empowered to protect themselves from these thousands of chemicals in daily life. And that now POPs are linked to consumer products is an opportunity to aware and educate consumer to reduce chemical exposure. In respect to the policymakers here, the European Sustainable Development Strategy state that the main challenge is to gradually change the non-integrated approach of policymaking. So the non-integrated approach of policymaking is the biggest hurdle acknowledged by the European Union to develop appropriate strategy for sustainable development. Important to change this is to go to science-based decision-making, which is a basis for sustainable development and the key for support of integrating decision-making, including decision-making on chemicals and waste. Some of the tools I have introduced during presentations, like, for example, material and substance flow analysis, which is really good to make policymakers understand. Life cycle assessment is very quantitative. It's complex, but also a very good tool to inform policymakers. Risk analysis, external costs, which I have shown you from science studies. So in Europe, we have a forward-looking decision-making approach. So this is for sure a key that we make better progress. So for this, we need awareness for policy and decision makers on their responsibility. But still at the moment, also in Germany, lobbyism and corruption are often the drivers for policy making, and this need to be changed. We need to come to a science-based policy making, including for chemicals and waste. Because what the science shows us is that humanity have crossed many planetary boundaries. So Rockström in 2009 published on the planetary boundary concept, and he showed that, for example, for biodiversity, but also for climate change, global boundaries are transpassed. And the International Panel on Chemical Pollution did an assessment in respect to chemical pollution. And also they showed for chemical pollution that we are crossing global boundaries. This has in the recent years been done also for plastics, where different research groups showed that global boundaries for plastic pollution, as you are obviously also see it, are transgressed. So, but still, when you look to projections of chemical production and also plastic production, all companies, all countries, all governments are estimated that we will have increasing chemical production, that we have a doubling of the plastic production. And by this, if we will not change, we certainly will shoot over global boundaries, which will impact our future generations. So therefore, what we see is that the impact of humans on today's Earth is crucial, and it is actually the main driver. So therefore, science community has concluded that we are living in the epoch of the Anthropocene. This means that the humans, this is the Anthropos, this is Greek, is the driver of today's change of the world. And these changes are, unfortunately, most of them are not good. So we have a global chemical and waste pollution, which demonstrate the crucial impact of humanity on the Earth system. We have climate change, we have biodiversity loss, we have degradation of soils and forests. We have a rapid degradation of the ecosystem services in the past 70 years. And the ecosystem services is how nature serves humanity. This includes the climate, for example, but also clean water, soil, the pollinators. And many of those have degraded over the last 50 years up to 50%. And actually, this is a degradation of the basis of livelihood of humanity and the ecosystem. So here, this really requires an adequate responsibility of all stakeholders, governments, industry, civil society, science, and for all of us, for all individuals. We need to take responsibility for this because we all impact. And up to now, most governments are not taking the responsibility, as you see, when they come together for negotiations on climate change, for example, in Glasgow. For chemicals, I think it is better when we have our meetings and the Basel Convention, we see that there are progresses, but also with SICEM, which is addressing all chemicals, we see that we hardly make a progress, and we have long discussions and no money to address really all chemicals. Already 50 years ago, the philosopher Hans Jonas wrote his book, The Principle of Responsibility, The Ethics for the Technological Civilization, because already 50 years ago, we could see that we have the power to destroy the Earth. Yeah, just thinking about weapons and nuclear weapons. So he said, we need another a responsibility, and we need to educate our children and our politicians about the responsibility. But what happens? What happens is that the dogma of growth the gross domestic product GDP lead us currently in the wrong direction. It directly lead us in an abyss. And what the driver is the capital. So therefore, probably we do not need to tell it that this is the Anthropocene. Yes, it's the humans, but actually the main driver is the capital. So we need other indicators. We cannot use the GDP and the growth as indicator for global progress. That's nonsense. What we need here is good scientific information, and this scientific information need to be tailored that stakeholder groups understand. One very good example is here the book Silent Spring from Rachel Carlson. She wrote in 1962. And in this book, she described how pops are destroying the environment and are accumulating in the animals and in birds, and that finally over the years, the birds are dying, that you have a silent spring. And because she wrote the book in a way and in a language that policymakers and the public could understand, because of that book was a big change. And for example, the environmental ministry was established in the United States. There are other books like Our Stolen Future, which are really talking in a language that policymakers and we can, and the general public can understand. Or I take this example of the slow death by Rubber Duck, which explains to the consumers what chemicals are in daily products and how they are affecting their health. And the most important is here that this information is scientifically sound and best practice, because only by scientifically sound information, we do not believe the fake news and run into the wrong direction. So also when we, with our chemical information, inform the media, which always want to have to sensation, we really need to explain it in the right way with the right arguments and the right studies. So there are a wide range of documents here from the UN, which can be considered as state of art information. We have shown in this workshop different documents from the Basel, Rotterdam, and Stockholm Convention. But there is, let's say, when we look to the bigger picture of chemicals, there is the UNEP Chemical Outlook from 2013 and from 2019, where I have put the links which address the status and the challenges, but also maybe the opportunities for chemicals in future. Also, I recommend you to have a look to UNEP chemicals and waste activities. And there are a wide range of good documents from different governments. One recommendation here is from the European Environmental Agency on late lessons from early warnings. So this includes the story of POPs and how long it takes that policymakers understand and take their actions, and that we need to learn from these lessons, and that the early warnings are important, that we move policy with policy. There are good reports of the Nordic ministers and also good reports from the US EPA, like their activities on the design for the environment. There are good publications and awareness materials from the science community. Here I would just highlight a few. The International Panel on Chemical Pollution is working on global pollution. I'm also a member there. We have statements from the science, like for example, the Madrid statement on PFAS, which you can also have a look at. And what I especially like with this Madrid statement, when we published it, the global organofluorine industry said, okay, if you publish it, then we want to publish in the same journal a commentary on your publication. And we said, yes, it is good. Yeah. And so we published our Madrid statement the global industry commented on it. Then we commented on the comments from the industry. And again, the industry comment on our comments. And I think this is a great example about communication and discussion of the different stakeholders. Good documents about plastic, which is one of the biggest issue, you can find on the Food Packaging Forum website. Also, WHO has good reports like this global assessment on endocrine disrupting chemicals, or here the global boundary concept I have introduced. And currently, there is a discussion on the establishment of an intergovernmental panel on chemicals and waste. So this would be a similar panel like the International Panel on Climate Change, where science come together globally to give a science policy advice. And actually, a friend of mine, Professor Scheringer from ETH Zurich, presented this 3 weeks ago at the Global POP conference. And currently, it is open for signature. So the scientists listening here can have a look to the website. And if they like, they can also sign. And at the next United Nations Environmental Assembly in February 2022, there will be a proposal on this international panel on chemical waste. And I have also put here the link to this event and to the document, which is describing it. And also there was a recent science paper on this international panel on chemicals and waste. Also, there are a range of good activities from global NGOs and good materials, which are especially good for consumers because they are often written in a language that a consumer can understand here. I give you a few websites, one from IPEN, International POPs Elimination Network, International Pollution Elimination Network, the Chemical Secretariat, especially on European chemical policy, and the International HCH and Pesticide Association on pesticide issue. And what I think is also and a positive activity, what I see is that face communities are increasingly addressing environmental and sustainability issues. And here there is a UNEP initiative to bring environmental issues to face communities and involve face communities in environmental education. And therefore, 2 years ago in the Environmental Assembly, many of FACE leaders were invited by UNEP to deliver the message, and that also this comes into our mosques here. You see green Muslims. I put a link also for the Jewish outdoor food and environmental education. I put a link, and for the Christian churches, I put two links, one of the Pope encyclica Laudato Si, which he has published and said that the environment is a key to care for, and to that somebody who believes in God have to take care of climate change and have to fight it. Also the link to the European Christian Environmental Network, which is quite active. So there are great documents for all pollutant exposure pathways. So here, I just give you, when you look to the life cycle, there are good from NGOs for teaching. There are a project, for example, from the Women for Environmental for Common Future, the project Nesting, how to reduce pollutant exposure for babies and kids. When you get a new child, there are good information materials about safe toys without hazardous chemicals, where I put the link. Of course, organic food, organic cosmetics, clean indoor environment, ecological construction and paints. Yeah, so you see how we can link it to our POPs. And also reduction of cleaning agents, and keep it simple. One option are here eco-labels. I just put here the eco-label from Europe, eco-label here for Germany, but also Israel has an eco-label which could be possibly used also in Palestine. I mean, the products often you get from Israel. And one big chance, what I see, is the internet and the Web 2.0 as a driver to get this information out. Because often scientific articles or books or leaflets have only a limited outreach today. But in the age of the web and the cyber world and the smartphones, it's easy to reach all stakeholder groups because all stakeholder and social groups are using internet and smartphones, even at high age. Therefore, there is already a range of apps for the smartphones, which are addressing chemicals in products. In Europe, we have a project of the governments to screen with the smartphones substances of very high concern. And by this screening and asking to producer, there is a database developed that by the smartphones, you can detect more and more products which include these substances of very high concern under the European REACH regulation. There are apps from different NGOs. Environmental Working Groups is one of the biggest apps on cosmetics, where cosmetics can be screened. Also other products from the environmental working groups. And also in Germany, we have specific apps, so-called ToxFox, where consumers easily can screen, for example, cosmetics, but also other products. And 4 years ago, the Chinese Environmental Ministry presented at COP7 a video game, the Pop Hunter. And I think this kind of out-of-box thinking can be really change makers. I mean, we should put our power, which the video games have, not into killing people, which most video games do at the moment, but we should use them for sustainability education. And I think here governments can and should do more. And I am happy that here the Chinese government is moving. And I think that films are one of the best tools to communicate sustainability and environmental issues, including chemicals and wastes. So we humans, we are visual creatures. So films with their pictures, their tone, their music, their emotions, they can reach the brain and the heart. So meanwhile, for almost all complex environmental and other sustainability related topics, including pollution and waste, we have high quality films. And for example, in Switzerland, there is one NGO which have compiled 500 films about all topics. And these films, they are showing to the public and also giving DVDs for free financed by some companies. And there is also another nonprofit website, Thought Maybe. And when I looked, I checked yesterday for this presentation if the web links are working. And I went on this Thought Maybe website, and the first film which they showed was about Palestine. So I have one recommendation for you, a great film. That's the film Home. So this film shows the beauty of the earth, the human development, and the impact which we have on the earth. And what I especially like of this film is that at the end of this film, he gives different positive messages. So I think that such films can really change the world. We see of the outreach power of films, the example of the film, the Chinese film Under the Dome. So this is about air pollution in China. So the Chinese ministry put it on the website. And within 1 week, this film had 110 million views in China within 1 week. So there are many short films for integrated information for in the workshop on chemicals and on waste, Some of them are, for example, this story of stuff or the IPEN film. So I know the topic of chemicals and to communicate it is really complicated. But by using short films, you can really easy start a workshop and show the message. So wait a moment. There is a saying from a Senegalese ecologist. He said, "We will conserve only what we love. We will love only what we understand. And we will understand only what we are taught." So therefore, information and awareness is key for human and society progress, and that we are not messing the entire planet. And at the moment, we are running towards that. So therefore, we need a change in policy and a change in behavior. And for this, we need awareness. So it needs an overall critical media self-education, because today to find the right message is very complicated in the world of fake news. I have here a link from an American university, which is just about critical media education. And I would recommend you to have a look at it. And I think also other countries should put this to universities, that at university, in school, and even in kindergarten, you start to get a critical media education. Chemicals and wastes are heavily impacting ecosystem services and therefore degrade the basis of human existence and development. So POPs are one of the most unsustainable inventions which we have, and they are a good tool to make awareness that we need to switch to sustainable and green chemicals and overall to sustainable production and consumption. So here, if we link chemical education, wait a moment, the last slide. Zack. Yes, so if we can link here, make a good link between chemicals and waste to the sustainable development goals. And there are many links to the sustainable development goals. There are negative links of chemical impacts, but there are also many positive impacts of chemicals. And of course, we need chemicals for all our products, for all our daily life. And also to achieve the sustainable development goals. So if we can make these links, especially for the SDG 12, this is, in my opinion, a good chance of substituting hazardous chemicals, including POP chemicals, by green and sustainable chemistry globally. And here the Stockholm Convention can be one entry for this change to go broader for all hazardous chemicals, considering SciChem and beyond SciChem 2020. Yeah, thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Roland. Thank you so much. Now I am giving the floor for the discussion. So if there anybody have any intervention, please go ahead.
Okay, one question in the chat is if it's possible to send the presentation. Yes, I mean, we will share the presentation, and I mean, yes, most of the information I have put links. Yeah, so I can also send it on your to your private email. Like I said, I will also give it to Yasser, and Yasser will share the presentations.
Yeah, because all the presenters, they have submitted their presentation to us, and I think we will share the presentation.
Bilal?
I think, I think Bilal has raised his hand. Bilal, please go ahead.
Just one question for Roland. Roland, you mentioned about equilibrium. Equilibrium in Israeli side, we know about it, but we have in BSI now like the basis for developing our equilibrium system. But until now, we didn't do that because of funding and other issue and technical issue. Other, I think it's important now to think as expert as you about responsibility of chemicals, not the impact only, but from my point of view, I doing many things about chemicals. It's now the world should think about the responsibility as we think before about the social responsibility in everything. Now it's the time to think about the responsibility related to the chemicals, not only for social, now the responsibility related to the chemicals. This is maybe the best point to the world to know what their responsibility. If you consumer, if you producer, if you the end user, all of them should be thinking about their responsibility about these products.
Yeah. No, yes, of course. I mean, you see with my presentation that I completely agree with you. I think one easy measure to see about the responsibility is this, the ecological footprint. So, I mean, you can calculate ecological footprints of societies, ecological footprints of individual consumers. And I have two children. And when they were young, I also showed them this ecological footprint, which is in the internet, and where you can then check how much you consume and how big your ecological footprint is. And I mean, this shows, especially for our societies, consumer societies, that our ecological footprint is, let's say, 3 times, 5 times, for some countries, even 8 times higher than what the earth could carry. And I mean, by this, then a person can understand the reduction which is needed. Yeah. And one is the CO2 reduction, yeah, where we see that our consumer societies are really emitting much too much, but it's also like by consuming too much textiles, consuming too much cars, new cars, the next new mobile phone. Yeah, that costs all resources, and this is what is finally impacting the environment and people. And often we do not see it. I mean, we can buy a shiny new mobile phone, a shiny new car, but we do not see how the resources were mined, how the people around these mines are suffering. And I think especially by these films, we need to educate, and it is first the education of our consumer societies. I mean, we need to change. Yeah, and only if we change here in Europe, and we show that also a lifestyle with a reduction is possible, and it's absolutely possible. I mean, actually, when we would reduce our consumption, we would not need to run and work, I don't know how many hours, and hunt for money. I think the life would be overall better. A friend of mine wrote a book about consumption, reduced consumption, and also what benefit it brings. Yeah, and I think that this is necessary to teach in societies. Yeah, in Palestine, for sure, you have a much smaller ecological footprint. Yeah, so yes, this is for each society different. But also, I mean, in your society, in all societies, you have upper class, and this upper class is often consuming without considering their impact. And they even think when they can show a bigger car that this is something positive. In my opinion, this is rather something negative.
Okay, thank you, Roland.